Hello, my friends. My name is Angela Nzilani. I am a motivational speaker. I am a life coach. I am a healed healer. And I want to give you a little bit of my story of what made me become all this. Because initially, when I started working, I was working as a contractor, a construction contractor. But my education is in accounts and marketing. A mixture of so many things. I'm a cocktail, I say that. Or I can say a fruit salad. So I went through some things in my life that made me become the person that I have become. And I had to make conscious decisions about what it is that I needed to become and be very clear about these things. And I want to be able to help you to also be clear about your life, about what you want to become, what you want to do, and how you want to even grow old doing. Well, I will not go far deep into my life except for what really made me become this. And I found myself being a single mother of one. My relationship with that, the father of my firstborn, did not work and couldn't work. So I started now being a single mother, and I was hardworking. I had an experience in the construction sector, having worked for a construction firm. So I continued, I opened my own company, which was doing quite well. I was doing construction projects and interior design. And I also introduced myself into agriculture, fabricating greenhouses. So I had a yard where I would fabricate greenhouses and install for people. Now, along the way, I think because I was a single mom and I had made myself to a place where I was comfortable, I started feeling the lack of a man, the lack of, you know, companionship, the lack of my son doesn't have a father, a present father. So I felt that I wasn't complete. I needed something. I needed that person. So I started praying. I started praying for a husband. And I don't know. Sometimes when you're praying, it's good to listen to what voice is talking back at you. And I don't know. I just met this person and he swept me off my feet. And sooner or later, we were already... we were all living together in just a few months of time, and this man moved into my house, and you're asking yourself questions. Now I ask myself those questions. I never asked myself then, and it's because I can't say that I really knew who I was. And one thing about life is that, and about relationships and marriage, is that many times we get into relationships without getting to even understand ourselves. We go looking for a soulmate. Well, you don't even know your own soul, what you're here for, what you're meant for, what you stand for, what vision you have in your own life. So I went into that, and it was a messy relationship because this guy came, I can say, empty-handed, apart from his suitcase of clothes, which had a Bible in it, which made me trust him, or kind of. That is what he had to offer in this marriage, this relationship. So we started staying together in a very short time. And I was doing everything. Remember, I was working already. I had a thriving business. So I started supporting him to bring out and grow his business. And as a father, I felt that, and a husband, I felt that he needed to have that. He needed to have that. I needed to support him to bring him to that level. And he was a foreigner. So I kind of excused so many things about him, and which I shouldn't have. But a man is a man. A man must, you know, play his role as a man. And mostly when you become a husband, you must play your role as a leader, as a provider. But I didn't get that from him. So our relationship went on swiftly and smoothly until a point when I couldn't provide anymore, until I got broke and Now this guy started cheating on me. He started going out, being a bit, being very promiscuous, and using my money to, you know, to go do all these things. He was a foreigner, so I had helped him to get work permits and a driving license, so he could drive my car whenever it feels like. After some time, now I couldn't totally provide. So now he started, because he was going out, he started coming home with money. And I would think that he was in the football business, bringing footballers from his country to Kenya and other countries around here. And all these footballers, I was housing them. I remember at some point I housed 6 men in my house, to take care of everything. So now they're living with us, and this man is living with me, and my son is there, and I'm the one providing. Until when I wasn't able to provide, now he's going out, coming home with money, and lying to me that people have signed up with him for him to manage them as a football manager. And it didn't work. I don't know. He would come home with money. And later on, I realized that he was getting money from women. He would go lie to women that he's single, he wants to marry them, and blah, blah. So, and I would buy it until a point when one of the lady was brave enough to want to know where he stays. And now everything came out to the open. So I started getting tired, and I prayed that God separate me from this man if he's not mine. And of course, I somehow I wasn't even paying attention to that prayer, but I think God had me, because even though it made me lose so much, he eventually separated me with this guy. When it reached a point where I couldn't continue lying anymore, he started asking or saying that he wants to go back to his country and make things right. And all this time I had stopped working because I was pregnant. So in December 2014, he left the country, and I had to help him leave because he didn't have money. So I sold my car and bought him tickets. So he left, and he was to come back in a few months before I have my baby. And the agreement was that he's going to sell some property that he had in his country, which wasn't true. So when he went, he just stayed, and he would send a little money here and there. Now at this time, I moved out from the big house I was staying to a smaller house, and I carried my luggage of this football man to my house. And I remember we stayed together up to the last week when I was about to deliver. So that is the time I told them that they just have to move out, because I cannot have a small baby, and my son is there also. So I had my baby, and I had no one to take care of me, and it was a cesarean. It was really tough, but somehow I managed. I got help from my brothers, my family members. I got some help and took care of my baby until now, because we were supposed to, this guy was supposed to come back, and we were in constant communication every day. So when I realized that he's not coming, we started talking about it, and he said that him coming is not easy, why don't we go and live with him? And because he has a house there, and I thought, why not? Because he's the father of my children after all, and he had accepted my firstborn. He had taught him how to pray, you know, he knew how to pray, but taught him. They would have man-to-man talk, and I really adored that. I loved that about the friendship. So now we agreed that we are going to go to his country and live with him, and it didn't work. So we agreed that I'm going to come to get the kids their passports, and I get mine, and he is going to get our tickets. So he did not get the tickets. I got the the passports ready, and I waited. My family came to bid me goodbye, and also, of course, to caution me and tell me, are you sure this is what you want to do? At that point, I had sold everything I had in my house. I had given out everything I had, some, of course, giving out to some people and selling others at throwaway prices. And we waited for the tickets, and the time we were supposed to go, we didn't go. So it was really tough on me. And anyway, fast forward, I think after 1 year of him being away, and us even still saying, waiting for him to send the tickets. And I was just hopeful. I don't know. I just have this kind of faith that is just strange. So he did not send the tickets. And then one day someone called me from his country, a lady, and she said that this guy has been lying to me. And the whole family has been lying to me. And I remember I was even talking to the mom and the sisters. They would assure me that they love me and my children and we will be fine. So this lady calls me and tells me that I've been lied to, that the guy is married. So yeah, so she told me that, and I couldn't buy it. So I told her to send me evidence of what she's talking about. She told me that she's the one who's been married to the guy for 10 years. So she sent me wedding album photos. It was really tough. I didn't know how to take it. I was devastated. Just to make it simple. And I didn't know what to do. I was already being housed by someone. My sister had taken me in, because when the time we were in preparation to leave, and I was to stay with her for 2 weeks. I ended up staying with her for 6 months. And now it was time for me to get up and start doing something. So, and when I look at my life, I'd never seen struggle or poverty, or so I never bought that idea of succumbing to, you know, to all this. So I never succumbed, and I started now going to people, telling them what happened to me. Even after I had taken so long without, you know, being close to them, because now I have, you know, a husband, of course. So this, I started going out. I was lucky to talk to a friend of mine who gave me some work, made some money, and moved out to a small house where I had to start life afresh. So I started hustling, going out, doing this, and just trying what could work for me. And of course, many things were not working. I wanted to go back to my construction field, and I was lucky that I could get a few things here and there to do, just small jobs here and there, and I wasn't choosy. I remember even one time I bought secondhand clothes to sell, and I did that for 2 months. It never worked for me. I wasn't happy. I didn't like the job, so I stopped it and continued just looking for something. And one day, you know, when I was praying also that God would help me really discover what it is that I want to do to grow old doing, so I started asking myself so many questions. And some of these questions were like, why do I have similar patterns in my life? Because this story resonates a little bit about what happened with the father of my firstborn. And I started asking myself, why these patterns? Why me? You know? And then what am I here for? I started asking myself, what was I created for? Because I remember in my Sunday school teaching, we were being taught that God created us to know Him, to love Him, and to serve Him. So I already knew who God is in my life, and I knew that I loved God. So my question was, how do I serve Him? How do I start serving Him? So I needed to discover what my purpose was. I didn't know at that time it is called purpose. Can you imagine? So and now I needed to start over, to think of what I need to do to start over living again. And one day I remember I was walking in town, and I met one guy who took me, who I told, he was in the construction field, and I told him that I wasn't doing so well, and I was looking for work, if he could give me some work. And he said, instead of taking you through work, giving you work in the construction field, of which I don't even have a job right now, come, I introduce you to something that you might like. So I went, attended an open day for a personal development class, and I was sure that this is going to help me, because at that point I felt that I needed counseling. But this one, when I saw the results of people who had graduated from that class, I just fell in love with it and I embraced it. I wanted to do it. But here I am, I'm not even working. I couldn't afford the guy. So I was lucky. He gave me a scholarship. I always tell him that he's my miracle. And his name is Stephen Muiru. He runs a company called Born to Lead Academy. So I owe it to him that I am here today. So I went through my personal development class and it was just awesome. I think for me, I can say it introduced me to myself. I didn't know who I was, and I started now embracing personal leadership, personal growth, and you know, self-awareness, emotions, working on my emotions, forgiving. And I can say there are some things that really worked for me after the whole class, because now I needed to start something of my own. I discovered that my purpose is to touch other people's lives, but I needed to be clear about how do I want to touch them. Everyone is here to touch another person's life. That's purpose. And you just need to be clear about what it is that you want to do, how you want to do it, who is your client, who is that person that needs you, who has been created and assigned to you for you to serve. So I discovered my purpose and I continued working on the journey towards trying to help people. And now here I am, I have embraced it, I have loved it, I have fallen madly in love with myself, to the point that anyone, you know, your love out there or your like out there is a plus. It's not something that is going to complete me. For me, I am complete, but all these other things are just plus. So I'm here to help you as a person to discover yourself, to start now living afresh, getting to understand who you are. Because many people are living a life of confusion, a life of they don't know what they're supposed to be doing. You're doing a job, but you don't like it, and you think that that is what life is supposed to be. Or you're in a marriage, and because you're married, you feel that you're complete because you have this person in your life. Marriage does not complete anyone. Neither does money complete anyone. So you need to discover who you are. And after I discovered myself, I needed to know, how do I want to be known in the, you know, in the world? Because purpose does not leave you, does not make you stay in your village. It will get you out of your village. You will go and face the world. The world is going to receive you. So I came up with Angelique Achievers, which for me is my tool. It's my vehicle that is going to help me to serve you more. I have looked and being able to see the need for transformation, for healing, and even walking through the journey with young people, teenagers. We don't have to have young people dying because they committed suicide or because they are going through depression. We need to help them overcome. We need to help them even discover their purpose early enough to be able to define who they are and who their friends should be. And that way we are going to have a better future for all of us. So our families are going to be happy. We are going to choose partners knowing what we are choosing and why we are choosing. So I'm here to help you discover your big why. What is your why of life? Why are you living? Why do you do the things you do? Why do you have patterns in your life the way, you know, whatever you've been doing? Well, how do you want to grow old? How do you want people to define you when you get out of this world? How do you want to grow old doing? What do you want to grow old doing? And, you know, such things. So I want you to start asking yourself those questions and get in touch with me. Follow me on my social media programs. And, yeah, you will thrive. I assure you that you will be transformed. You will love your life and you will have someone to serve or people to serve. You start with one and continue. You never stop. Thank you.